This is Josiah Plays Lone Wolf, Book 4, The Chasm of Doom. You are Lone Wolf, last of the Kai Lords. To the south of your homeland of Summerland lies the rich but remote mining province of Ruinon. When a regular shipment of gold suddenly vanishes, the king dispatches a patrol of his best cavalry to investigate the suspected theft. They do not return. In the Chasm of Doom, you are sent to recover the missing gold and locate the lost patrol, but you soon discover that it is a mission of direful consequence, for the fate of your country is at stake. Welcome. Welcome to the Chasm of Doom, Book 4 of the Lone Wolf Adventure Book series. Here is what the cover of the original American publication of the book looked like. I owned this book. This is what the cover of the one that I owned way back in the 80s looked like when I was a kid. And I liked this one. I thought this was a very dynamic and cool cover. Got a big battle going on, and this horse is leaping over the lines with this sort of exotic-looking warrior. The painted shield and the helm and the spear come down, and here's Lone Wolf with his green Kai cloak trying to defend. Pretty cool. Pretty cool, this book. Chasm of Doom. So, we just got back from Cult. From the Caverns of Cult, which was book 3. We were successful with that one. And now we're going to be starting on the next book. These books were written by Joe Deaver and originally illustrated by Gary Chalk. And the music you're hearing, all of it in the whole video, will be music by Kevin MacLeod, who is at incompetech.com. So let's move on and do this. We've got stuff about the author and the illustrator, dedications, acknowledgments. And then we come to the story so far. Ruinon is a remote mining province to the south of your homeland, Summerland. Nestling between the sullen peaks of the Dern Crag and Machen Mountains, the people of this province have long prospered from their toil in the ore-rich mines, living and enjoying their wealth under the protection of their lord, Baron Vanilund. The gold and gems that are mined at Ruinon yield an important source of revenue to your homeland. The heavily guarded convoy of wagons that leave the province and journey to the capital has become a regular monthly routine. A routine that had never been broken until 1 month ago, when, suddenly, all contact with Ruinon ceased. A troop of 100 cavalry from the King's Guard were immediately dispatched to investigate the whereabouts of the missing convoy. Their commanding officer, Captain Duval, was ordered to report back to the King as soon as contact was made, but he and his men have not returned. They, too, have disappeared without trace. The king has summoned you, Lone Wolf, last of the Kai Lords, to his citadel at Holmgard. Your quest is to find Captain Duval and his men, discover what has happened to the missing convoy, and to uncover the veil of mystery that now hangs over Ruinon. The king has gathered a company of border rangers, a unit of elite scouts, all of whom are skilled in horsemanship and outdoor survival. He has ordered these 50 men to accompany you in the hope that with your leadership, they may succeed where the larger and more visible force failed. As you and your men enter the royal armory to equip yourselves for the long ride ahead, you glimpse a black crow perched on a window ledge high above. It flies away, but not before a shiver has run down your spine. In Holmgard, the crow is a bird of ill omen. So that is the story leading into our adventure today. Game rules have not changed. As it says, we carry over our stuff and our disciplines from the previous books, and I now may choose one additional Kai discipline. And the one I am going to choose this time There are only three left that I haven't chosen. Mind Blast, Mind Shield, and Weapon Skill. Today I'm going to choose Mind Shield. Some of the hostile creatures of Magnabund have the ability to attack you using their mind force. The Kai discipline of Mind Shield prevents you from losing any endurance points when subjected to this form of attack. So Mind Shield is what we're going with. We're going to learn to protect our mind from psychic bullshit. And we'll be moving forward. Equipment. Before leaving Holmguard on your ride south, you are given a map of the Southlands. Let's take a look at the map of the Southlands. I like how we get different maps in the different books. Last time we had a map of Kalt. Before that we had a little bit more northerly map. You can see some of what was on our first map here. You can see Holmguard there. That's the city that we traveled to in Book 1. And we traveled away from and back to in Book 2. That's the capital of Somerland. Somerland, though, most of the actual nation of Somerland is up here. It's to the north. Ragadorn, that is where we washed ashore after our shipwreck and we were robbed of everything we owned. So Ragadorn, not a nice town. And then up over here, which you can't see underneath the key, is where Durinor is, where we went to get the Summer Sword. But now we have the map extending much further south to a whole bunch of new areas. We've got Rhyme. Got some kind of inland sea here. There's the Machenmire Swamp. Cassiorn. There's a desert here with an oasis and everything. And here's southern Somerland, being that part which borders upon Vasagonia. Here's the northern part of Vasagonia. There's the banner of Ferufezan. There's Ferufezan right there, and that's what its banner looks like. Pretty cool banner. And here's Ruinon, which is our destination today. The Machen Mines. So we are heading from Holmguard down to Ruinon. Pretty cool. Alright. We're given a map, a badge of rank that you wear upon the sleeve of your tunic, and a pouch of gold. Random number for the gold, we get a 9, very lucky. Add 10 to that number, that's 19, and we can add it to any gold that we already have. We already have 16. So now we have 35. Now we have 35 crowns. Hopefully we don't get them all robbed from us again. And we still have some items left over from last time. Some of which we may end up getting rid of. Some of which we may end up losing. We'll see. You may take your pick of the following items in addition to those you already possess. You may take up to 6 of the following. Up to 6. They get a lot more generous with the gear as the books go on. Like in the first book it was really stingy with the gear they gave you. Alright, we don't need any weapons. We're good on weapons. See, now they'll give you 2 potions of Lumsfer as a single item. Sword, spear, and they'll give you 5 meals as a single item. If you need them. Oh, chainmail waistcoat. I had one of those and we lost it. When our ship went down. So I'm gonna get a chainmail waistcoat. I'm gonna get rid of my padded leather waistcoat. And replace it with a chainmail waistcoat, which gives 4 endurance instead of 2. I'm having some issues here, apparently, with the keyboard. So we go back here. Now we have 28 endurance. Oh, and I can get a shield too. I also had my shield stolen in Ragadorn, so finally get a shield back. That'll make this a 10, as we add a shield to our life. So I can get 6 items, I just chose 2. I'll take these 2 potions as well. Now, I have 2 potions already. This one says it heals 5 endurance, and I don't remember where I got this one, or whether or not that was true, or whether I made a mistake. But because I don't remember and I don't want to screw up, I'm just gonna make these uniform, and I'm just gonna change this to 4. so that they all heal the same amount. Because that might have been a mistake. It might not have ever been 5. Because every other one I've ever seen, it always says 4, so... But each one of these is a separate item that takes up one of my 8 slots. So... Let's just see if I can make this a little quicker. Yeah, I can. Alright. And there's my rope, which takes up 2 slots. Now I have 2 slots left over. I'll take some meals. I can get 5 meals, but I only have space in my backpack for 2, so I'll just take 2 meals. And that's counted as taking 4 items out of my 6, so I'm not going to take anything else, because I'm maxed out on weapons, maxed out on backpack space. So we're done equipping ourselves. This just tells you a bunch of stuff that is the same as always. Rules for combat are the same as always. Levels of Kai training. We are now a journeyman, or a warmarn. That's rank 8, which is the rank we are. This tells you kind of the same thing as in every book. And here we get to the first actual numbered section. The actual story begins here. So, let's do this. I'll drink a little water and then we'll get going.
For 3 days, you lead your brave company of rangers across the lush plains of southern Summerland on the first stage of your urgent mission. The flat, treeless fields surround you with a seemingly endless expanse of wheat, so high that even though you're in the saddle, it reaches well above your knees. Your horses seem to be swimming through a vast yellow sea of corn that is only interrupted by an occasional track or group of isolated farmhouses. The southerners welcome your sudden appearance, but you only make the briefest stops for food and rest, neither wishing to risk becoming a burden nor alarm these good people with your mission. By noon on the 4th day, you reach the pass of Moitura. Here, the plains give way to the broken foothills of the Dern Crag Mountains. You soon reach a highway, the surface cracked and full of potholes, heading off towards the south. This is the notorious Ruinon Pike. South of the pass, the Ruinon Pike crosses 100 miles of open territory known as Raider's Road. Bandit tribes from the wildlands and Giak war bands from the mountains of the west frequently ambush those who travel along the pike, and the regular shipment of gold and gems from the mines at Ruinon have sometimes yielded rich pickings to these merciless robbers. "Point and flankers!" you shout, and immediately 3 groups of rangers peel away from the column and spur their horses to a gallop. You watch with pride as the expert horsemen take up their scouting positions to the front and side of the company. It is late afternoon when a ranger scout approaches the company from the west. He points towards a craggy outcrop where a thin spiral of wood smoke betrays a hut hidden beneath the overhanging rock. "I can investigate the hut, or ignore it and continue on." "Well, I think I'm going to investigate the hut. Come on. You know how I do." An escort of 5 rangers accompanies you along the twisting narrow track that leads to the hut. The rough stone walls are covered with a damp moss into which is set a curious oval door. There are no windows. You have dismounted and are approaching the door when suddenly a man's voice calls from inside the hut. "Come in, lone wolf. I've been expecting you." I could send my rangers in. That's kind of cowardly. "Kick open the door, or just open the door and enter." I'm just going to open the door and enter. In the dim light of the interior, you see an old man seated at a table. The flicker of a log fire is all that illuminates this foul-smelling hovel. Yet it sheds enough light for you to see the clutter of charts and strange instruments that crowd the hut. The man slowly raises his gaze from a large crystal sphere and bids you sit opposite him. "You know my name?" "How?" you ask warily.
"The stars foretold our meeting long ago, lone wolf,"
he replies, slowly passing his withered old hands around the sphere. Be not alarmed by my knowledge, for I wish only to aid you.
He produces a small scroll of parchment from within his robe, and he hands it to you. Upon the scroll is written the following verse. When the full moon shines o'er the temple deep, a sacrifice will stir from sleep the legions of a long-forgotten lord. When a fair royal maid on the altar dies, the dead of Macangorge shall rise to claim their long-awaited reward. Let's take a second to dissect that. Or digest it, or do something with it. Full moon, temple deep, underground temple, sacrifice stir from sleep, that sounds like some undead business. Legions of a long forgotten lord, yeah, undead legions. When they sacrifice a fair royal maid on the altar, the dead rise, yeah, once again. Claim there. Yeah, so this is sounding creepy. This is a creepy prophecy. Here's the old man. Got that Gary Chalk illustration. Big crystal ball, bigger than I would expect. That's pretty huge. And he gives no fucks about haircuts or trimming his beard or anything. You ask the meaning of the strange verse, but the old man does not answer you. He seems to have fallen into a deep trance. You lean across the cluttered table to awaken him and are shocked to see your hand pass straight through his body. Gradually, his image begins to fade. Within seconds, he has disappeared completely. You place the scroll in your pocket. It's a special item. You quickly leave the hut, pausing only to wipe the cold sweat from your brow. Yeah, this was a bit of a creepy encounter. Scroll. Alright. Turn to 273. You know, I'm gonna notate here. Entry 84. In case I want to reference this again, I can come back to 84 and see what's on the scroll. I doubt that I will, but you never know. You have ridden less than 5 miles when you see a group of wagons on the highway ahead. They are painted in a gaudy mix of bright colors and drawn by teams of oxen. A huge tasseled banner flies above the leading wagon, which bears the following proclamation. The famous Azagir players, troubadours to the Imperial Courts of Magnamund. And here's the illustration. Some troubadours right there. That guy looks like he's troubadoured himself out. And they've got a picture of a woman with a blindfold and a sword here. Just because, I guess. My music's not too loud, is it? I think it's the same volume that I always have it at, yeah. Kevin MacLeod, how you doing, Kevin? I don't think Kevin MacLeod is watching my videos. Seems unlikely. Okay, so we can stop to question these traveling minstrels, or we can ignore them and let them pass. Well, we're not going to ignore anything. Leave no stone unturned in our investigation. Maybe they know something. You signal to the driver to stop. The wagons halt, and a small, moon-faced man in a bright pink tunic throws open the rear door of the leading carriage. He shouts and curses the driver as he descends the ladder, pausing only to adjust the cummerbund that barely covers his huge stomach. Seeing your men, he lets out a strangled shriek and fumbles for a short sword hanging at his side. Bandits! Robbers! He cries, and rustles to free his sword from its ornate scabbard. A row of anxious faces appears at the wagon windows, but the expressions soon change to a smile when they recognize your Somlending uniforms.
Calm yourself, Yesu!
Shouts an elderly woman.
They're some lending rangers! They will not steal your gold!
Laughter ripples along the carriages as the little fat man suddenly unsheathes his sword with such force that he spins around and tumbles to the ground. Here's an illustration of him spinning around and tumbling to the ground. He looks like a pretty silly individual. So this guy's kind of a fool, is what we're getting.
You must forgive Yesu, says the old woman. He means you no harm. Raider's Road has made him a nervous wreck.
You question the old woman, asking her where they have come from and their destination. You learn that they are a troop of players and have journeyed many miles from their native land of Cloesia in the east. They last played for the people of Eshnar, but it was a disappointing show. It seems that the town was as quiet as the grave. Those who did come to see them were a sad and sorry crowd. They are now bound for Holmgard and hopefully a more appreciative audience.
Light is fading, remarks the old woman. Perhaps you and your men will camp with us tonight. We would deem it an honor and would be happy to entertain you. All with songs and dancing.
You notice a hopeful look in the eyes of your men as they await your decision. All right, we will set up camp with the troubadours. Might be a terrible idea, but let's do it. The wagons are drawn into a circle, and you set up camp inside. A ranger is posted to patrol the perimeter. Only one? I've got 50 rangers. We got one patrolling the perimeter? The troubadours construct a small stage onto which strides Yesu. He calls for silence before announcing the title of their play, The Brave Warriors of Sommerland, a choice that meets with the hearty approval of your men. During the performance, you notice something very odd. Not only is one of the actors using a real sword, but it is a type of sword only issued to officers of the Somlending Cavalry. After the play, you approach the man to question him about the sword. He looks at you nervously and makes a dash for the darkness of the perimeter wagons. I can chase him using tracking or hunting. I have both of those. Or I can let him go. I'm going to chase him with tracking and hunting, both. I'm going to hunt and track this man. Although the wagons are shrouded in darkness, your Kai sense reveals to you the actor's hiding place. You climb the ladder at the rear of a large caravan, push open the door with your weapon, and enter. In the plush, candlelit interior of the caravan, you find the actor cowering beneath a blanket in the far corner. You flick the blanket aside and ask the petrified man to explain how he came to possess such a fine sword.
I bought it in Eshnar, he stammers, his eyes wide with fear. From the innkeeper of the Pick and Shovel Tavern.
He grasps the sword by the blade and offers it to you.
If it's your sword I've unwittingly bought, I'm truly sorry. Here, please take it.
You grip the brass hilt and examine it closely. There is no doubt, it is a Somlending cavalry sword, but the inscription on the blade makes your heart miss a beat. Captain Ramir Duval, King's Guard Regiment. You want to keep it? Mark Captain Duval's sword on your action chart as a weapon. I will keep it, because I might want to be able to return it to him. Captain, I'm going to get rid of my dagger. Duval's sword. Sword. Officially have a lot of stuff now. Just took this dude's sword. But where did he get it, really? Or how did this innkeeper get it? Because Captain Duval was the leader of the soldiers who came down here to investigate this thing and is now also missing. You return to the troubadour stage in time for a meal that has been prepared by your hosts. The steaming broth smells most appetizing. I can accept the meal or decline. I'm surprised I don't get like a sixth sense choice here. I'll accept the meal. Why not? I don't want to be rude. The food is delicious. You eat your fill and then make preparations for a good night's sleep. At dawn, you and your company bid farewell to the traveling players and continue on your mission to Ruinon. And now it's make a random roll time to see if something terrible happens. I got a 7. So 5 to 9, here we go. Mile after mile, you ride across the flat and desolate landscape surrounding the Ruinon Pike. You have entered the wildlands south of the Pass of Moitura and cannot use the Kai discipline of hunting to hunt for food in this desolate area. It seems like you can't use hunting for food more often than you can use it. Like, the only book in which I actually got to use it on a regular basis was book one. Yet in spite of the uninspiring view, your men seem in fine spirits. They sing rousing marching songs to relieve the tedium of the journey and help to allay fears of what may lie ahead. During the afternoon, storm clouds gather above the peaks of the Dern Crag Mountains to the west, and the roll of distant thunder warns of imminent rain. And then we see this place, a shadowy-looking tavern. It is late afternoon when your scouts sight a coaching tavern on the highway ahead. It is a large stone building that has been fortified. Stop there for the night or brave a possible storm and continue south. We will stop at the tavern for the night. Why not? The sound of a tolling bell drifts across the barren landscape. Window shutters slam down, but eyes still peer at you from the arrow slits carved into the walls. You draw your company to a halt outside the wide tavern doors. "We are some lending. We seek shelter for the night and fodder for our mounts," you shout. There is a long pause before a voice answers your call. Pick a random number to discover the nature of the reply. Random number again, huh? We got an 8. So let's see what that gets us. "What proof have we that you're not bandits in stolen uniforms?" What can you say or do that will convince them that you speak the truth? I can show them my badge of rank, or I can say that I'm a Kai Lord. I'm just going to be honest. Tell them I'm a Kai Lord and that my men are border rangers of Somerland. "Go away!" shouts a nervous voice. "We're a tavern, not a barracks!" shouts another. You try to reason with them, but they are adamant. They will not let you enter. You have no choice but to continue along the highway. Well, fine then. These people are scared. Something terrible must be going on down in this region. You have not ridden far when a storm cloud breaks directly overhead and torrential rain crashes down. Within minutes, the dry and dusty highway is transformed into a quagmire. It will be impossible to set up camp in this storm, so you resolve to continue to ride all night in the hope that the storm will soon pass. During your night ride, you must eat a meal or lose 3 endurance points. And it says I can't use hunting, so I have to eat an actual meal, so I'm glad I took these meals. 1 meal, gone. By morning, the rain has ceased, but you and your men are now very tired from the ordeal. Yeah, sounds crappy, riding all night in the rain, not sleeping. You are about to order your men to make camp when a scout gallops towards you from the east. He points to a line of horsemen on the horizon. "Bandits!" he cries. You estimate that there are at least 200 of them, and they are riding in your direction. "I have reached the Kai rank of Warmarn." So if you hadn't done all the books up to this point, you would have to go here and be lame. But since I have, I get to do the awesome thing. The flat wildlands offer no cover in which to hide from the bandit horde. You know that if you are to avoid combat with an enemy which vastly outnumbers you, you must split up your company and try to outrun them. You detach a troop of 10 rangers to follow you and send the remainder off toward the west in the hope that they may lure the bandits away to the Dern Crag Mountains. With one last glance at the enemy,
You lead your 10 rangers on a deadly race along the Ruinon Pike. So I've already lost 40 of my rangers, basically. How long will it be before I lose the rest? Probably not long. Your tactics have worked. The bandits ignore your small group of horsemen and pursue the others toward the west. Once they reach the wooded foothills of the Dern Crag Mountains, your rangers will have no difficulty evading the enemy among the densely packed firs. When the bandits have disappeared from view, you call a halt and allow your men to rest. In spite of the number of men you have lost, they are still eager to continue the mission. Pick a random number. I got a 5 this time. That just barely makes it into 5 to 9. After many hours of riding, you reach a highway junction. You have left the wildlands and may once again use the Kai discipline of hunting to hunt for your food. That's good. A large signpost indicates 2 destinations, south to Ruinon, 60 miles, and east to Eshnar, 40 miles. I kind of want to go to Eshnar so I can question that innkeeper about where the hell he got the sword. I'm doing it. Might be a bad idea. Again, you know, sometimes there are very bad ideas in these books, and sometimes I don't care and I try them anyway. I managed to make it through book 3 without dying ever, but I died once in book 1 and 2, and I might die in this one. It is noon on the following day when you reach the outskirts of Eshnar. To the south, the wooded hills To the south, the wooded hills gradually ascend towards the magnificent snow-capped peaks of the Machen Range. It is a beautiful sight, one of stark contrast to the squalor of Eshnar and the desolate wildlands to the north. You ride along the only street in this dilapidated town and eventually arrive outside a large tavern called the Pick and Shovel. That's where the guy said he bought the sword. Your men are exhausted and badly in need of food and rest. I can use 6 cents here, so I will. You have a very uneasy feeling about this town. So far, you have only seen women and children shuffling along the street. There has been no sign of any men whatsoever. The inhabitants all seem nervous and avoid looking you directly in the eye. Instinct tells you to turn around and leave as quickly as possible. I kind of want to investigate the tavern regardless of my instincts. I mean, it's probably a bad idea, but I feel like there's a real clue to be found here. So I'm going to investigate the tavern anyway. Your men tether their horses and follow you into the tavern. An old woman stands behind the bar, her face taut and lined as if in pain. She wears men's clothes, a shirt, and checkered trousers. The tavern is empty, but the tables are covered with ale mugs, many half full of beer. So this place has been abandoned. Maybe the bandits are like from this town and they've all run off because we were coming. I'm gonna question the old woman. You have barely taken a dozen steps when the old woman drops to the floor. A ranger shouts, "Ambush!" It is the last word he will ever speak. A razor-sharp disc of metal whistles down from the balcony above and sinks into his chest. Then, suddenly, the tavern is full of bandits. I was right. Pouring in through windows and doors. 3 charge straight at you, their battle cries loud and savage. You draw your weapon and strike, beheading two of the dark-skinned warriors with a single blow. The 3rd bandit is upon you before the bodies of the others have fallen to the floor. Just beheaded 2 dudes with 1 swing. I would think that 3rd guy would be like, "Nah, I'm good. We don't need to fight." Alright, well, I have to fight this bandit warrior now. Which I'm not real concerned about, to be honest. His combat skill is much less than mine, so I should pretty much kick his ass. So, here we go, round 1. Yeah, I lost no endurance in round 1, and he lost 18 endurance in round 1. Let's check out round 2. Round 2, I also lost no endurance, and he lost all the remains. So, I just cut that guy down with 2 quick slashes while not even getting touched in return. That's what I'm talking about. I'm Lone Wolf. I got a shield now, and the Somersword. What's up, kids?
just attacking me like he thinks something's gonna happen. You win the fight. Turn to 75. Let's do this.
No sooner has the first warrior collapsed when another is hacking at you from the side. As you turn to face him, a spear thrust gashes your left arm and you lose 2 endurance points.
Alright, that's rude.
You recoil in pain, and in the crush of battle, you slip and fall to the floor, which is already strewn with bodies. Then you glimpse an open door and crawl towards it. Did I just get all of my 10 rangers slaughtered? If so, I feel a little bit bad for that. But we figured it out, though. This is where the bandits are that killed the other soldiers. I mean, that's how they got Captain Duval's sword. So, I mean, we were kind of looking for these bandits, weren't we? Alright, I can pick a random number, and because I possess the Kai discipline of camouflage, I can add 3 to the number I picked. So obviously I need to get high here. So I need to get a 3 or higher, is what it looks like. And I got exactly a 3, so I got exactly a 6, which will get me into the better... I'll bet this is instant death right here. Alright, turn to 16. You reach the door and quickly make your escape. The land behind the tavern is steep and heavily forested. 2 of your men follow, but they are both badly wounded and cannot keep up with you. You turn to shout encouragement, only to witness their deaths as they are brutally stabbed to the ground. The bandit murderers wipe their blades and sprint towards you.
So I did get all my guys killed. Oops.
I could run straight into the forest, or try to change direction as soon as the trees hide me from my pursuers. That seems smarter.
Alright, let's do this direction change nonsense.
As you part the dense foliage, you suddenly topple headlong over the edge of a steep drop and fall with a crash onto a wide forest track below. Less than 10 feet away kneels a bandit, examining the hoof of his horse and prizing out a sharp stone from the animal's shoe with a long, curved dagger. The noise of your fall alerts him, and he turns with his weapon raised for attack.
And then I have to fight him. Although I just realized something. Alright, yeah, I can heal... No. I can heal myself of 1 point, because there was 1 section in between there. Bandit warrior, let's do this battle. He's even weaker than the last guy, though, so I'm not concerned. Alright, 27-24. Round 1, I lost 2. He lost 12. Round 2, I lost 2. He lost all the rest. Another 12. So he did manage to wound me a little bit. But I took him out without too much difficulty.
If you win the combat, you notice that a group of bandits are closing in from the north. You spot them just in time to make a hasty escape.
Onward and upward, you claw your way through the wooded hillside. Your throat is dry and your heart is pounding, as though it is about to burst, but you dare not slacken your pace.
4 hours pass before you feel certain that you have outrun the enemy. It is nearly dusk when you chance upon a narrow, steep-sided valley carved from the hillside to afford access to a mine tunnel. For hundreds of years, the ore of the Machen Range has been the blessing and the bane of many who have ventured here to seek their fortune. Men have found wealth beyond their wildest dreams, but also men have perished without trace in its labyrinth of cold, dark tunnels. You examine the mine entrance. You know that if you can find a major passage, you could trace your way to Ruinon itself. At the entrance, you find a discarded wooden crate containing 6 torches and a tinderbox. The mines are dark, and you will need to use at least 1 torch to light your way. You can take as many additional torches as you wish, but remember, each one counts as a backpack item, so be sure to make the appropriate changes to your action chart. Note number 6 here says, unless you already possess an alternative means of relighting the torch later, e.g. another tinderbox or a cult fire spear, record this tinderbox on your action chart as a backpack item. It is not necessary to record the 1 lit torch on your action chart.
Okay. I do have a fire sphere, actually. So I'm not going to need to take a tinderbox. But I do need... I am going to take an extra torch. Actually, I don't care if I miss a meal, so I'll take two torches just in case. Two torches plus the one that I'm carrying, apparently. And I will enter the mines. In the flickering light of your torch, you can see that the tunnel is supported by a crisscross of props and beams. The rock is damp, and a narrow rivulet of ore-stained water runs along the tunnel floor. You soon reach a junction where the tunnel heads off to the left and right. I will use the Kai discipline of tracking. You sense that the left tunnel leads away from Ruin On. Without hesitation, you turn and head off towards the right. Good to know. Nice to have tracking. The tunnel descends for miles into solid rock. You are occasionally startled by unexpected swarms of glowing mine flies or fluttering bats swooping out of the darkness, attracted by your body heat. Glowing mine flies sound interesting. And of course there's bats, sure there are. You eventually reach a chamber where a small wooden hut has been built against the wall. You are now desperately tired and in need of sleep. I will rest in the hut. Oh, hold up. 1, 2, 3, 4. Healing myself. Rest in the hut. And I restored. Okay, so I'm fully healthed up here. Extinguishing your torch, you curl up on the floor and quickly fall into a deep sleep. Many hours pass before you awake, totally refreshed by your rest. Restore 2 endurance points. Relighting your torch, you can now see that the hut is full of mining tools. Picks, shovels, and wheelbarrows are stacked upright along the far wall. If you wish to take either a pick or a shovel, do so and mark it on your action chart as a backpack item. Due to the size of these tools, they each take up the same amount of space as 2 normal backpack items. Oh, see, now we got inventory drama. Now I gotta decide. First of all, do I want a pick or a shovel? I mean, I could take both, but that's a lot of inventory. I feel like a shovel is more generally useful, but a pick in some circumstances is really what you'd want to have, especially since we're in a mine. I don't mind tossing out some of these healing potions, to be honest. I never actually use them, and I've got 4 of them. I'll destroy a couple healing potions. I don't need them. With my healing discipline that lets me heal in between each thing I go through. So, should I take a pick or a shovel? I'll take a pick. Maybe I should take a shovel also. Get rid of 1 torch. Carry 1 extra torch. And take a shovel also. Because you never know, you know? If I need these things, I would like to have them. I just threw away 3 healing potions. How often do you do that in a game? Alright, but now I have a pick and a shovel and an extra torch and a rope. So I'm ready for anything, really. 2 tunnels lead away from the chamber. 1 heads west, the other south. No tracking this time to help me. Which way did I already go? It didn't tell me which direction I was going. It just says left or right.
Well, if I take a look at my map, I can see that Eshnar is over here. So I entered the mines over here somewhere, and I'm trying to get to Ruinon, so I need to go southwest. Of course, south and west both kind of go in the right direction, so I guess it's just a crapshoot at this point. I'll take the west tunnel. No, I lied. I'll take the south. I'm going south. Don't try to stop me. You soon arrive at a collapsed section of the tunnel. A wide rift has appeared in the floor, and a makeshift bridge has been thrown across it. In spite of the many gaping holes in the bridge floor, you make your way safely to the other side. You are hungry and must now eat a meal or lose 3 endurance. You possess hunting. You're unable to use it within the Mac and Mine. Unable to use hunting again. What a shocker. And I got rid of all my meals, so I'm going to lose 3 endurance here. And we'll keep going. And I'll start healing myself. You follow the tunnel for 3 hours before arriving at a great hall where several tunnels, all at different depths, meet up. A series of wide stone ramps connect each tunnel to those immediately above and below. 4 levels below you, teams of men are pushing wagon loads of ore. Others, dressed in red armor, stand guard over the wagon pushers and urge them on with whips and curses. The tunnel in which you now stand is on the highest level. You realize that the only way you can proceed is by descending the ramp to a tunnel on a lower level. To your dismay, you notice that each of the ramps is guarded by armed men. Inching forward, you peer over the edge of the ramp. 2 guards are sitting near the tunnel entrance below. They are laughing and giggling and pointing at an empty wine flagon that lies at their feet. After watching them for several minutes, you decide they are probably too drunk to notice you. You decide to make a dash for the tunnel. Pick a random number. If you have camouflage, you can add 4. So it looks like I need an 8, and I add 4, so I get. It looks like I need to roll a 4. And I got a 0, which means I did not make it. So, looks like I gotta fight some drunken guards. You are halfway down the ramp when a guard turns to face you. He blinks and rubs his bloodshot eyes in disbelief. You seize your advantage and sprint at the man, hoping to reach him before he fully comes to his senses. Just as he begins to shout, you strike and send him tumbling over the edge of the ramp. The other guard draws his sword and staggers to his feet. He is obviously very drunk and is maddened by your attack. He springs towards you like a rabid dog. Alright, well, this rabid dog's about to get put down. Because with his 13 combat skill, he doesn't really have a chance. Alright, round 1. I lost 3, he lost 9. Okay, he's hanging in there pretty tough, actually. I lost 2, he lost 12. This should end it right here, round 3. I lost a couple more. He's dead. Goodbye, drunken guard. Goodbye. But I am actually taking some reasonably significant endurance losses here. Endurance is kind of getting down there a little bit. I win the combat. 152. Okay, so a quick search of the body reveals the following items. A sword, 6 gold crowns, enough food for 2 meals, and a brass key. Well, I will take the 6 crowns, giving me 41. And I will take the brass key, but I'm not going to take the food. You may take any of these items, but remember to mark them on your action chart. As you turn to enter the tunnel, a guard appears on the ramp below. He sees you and sounds the alarm by blowing on a war horn strung around his neck. You do not stay to witness the response to his alarm signal.
With its sound ringing in your ears, you escape into the tunnel at a run. Running down the tunnel. Healing myself also. Healing myself some more. The hoarse cries of the guard echo along the tunnel. You soon reach a section where repairs are in progress. A prop in the center of the passage supports a cracked roof beam. If you could just knock away the prop, it might cause the roof to fall in, which would seal off the passage behind you. You could now hear the running footsteps of more than one guard approaching. That seems like a terrible idea. You're in a mine. You do not start knocking stuff down and causing shit to collapse. You don't know what else it's gonna cause to collapse. That's madness. No, I'm not gonna do that. I'm gonna ignore the prop and press on along the tunnel. And I'm gonna heal myself. You can hear the harsh breath of the guards close behind you. Suddenly, the tunnel narrows and divides in two. If I possess tracking or sixth sense, both of which I possess, I will use those Kai disciplines. Your Kai sense reveals that the right tunnel is a dead end. Anxious not to get trapped by your pursuers, you turn and run into the left tunnel. Thank you, tracking. Thank you, sixth sense. You soon enter a chamber divided by a deep mine shaft. Spanning the shaft is a wooden bridge at the entrance of which a swarthy warrior stands guard. He has been alerted by the screams of your pursuers, and as soon as he sees you, he runs toward a rope that hangs from the ceiling, leaving the bridge unguarded. Your pursuers are nearly upon you. I can sprint across the bridge or attack the guard to prevent him from reaching the rope. I'm gonna attack the guard. You hit the guard and open a deep wound in his neck. He screams and turns to face you, a short sword in his hand. Alright, this guy's easy meat. 12 combat skill, 18 endurance, cut the games. This guy's gonna go down like a punk. Round one, I lose no health, he dies instantly. Just cut that dude's head clean off. I won and the fight lasted for 3 rounds or less. Thank you. As you step over the dead guard, you follow the line of the hanging rope to a pair of locking pins, which secures the bridge to the edge of the mine shaft. If the guard had pulled the rope, the bridge would have fallen away and you would have been trapped on this side of the chamber. See, that's what I thought was going to happen. You run across the bridge just as your pursuers enter. A rope, similar to the one opposite, hangs from the ceiling next to the tunnel entrance in the west wall. You look back to see that your pursuers are now halfway across the bridge. Well, if I pull the rope, it will drop them into the chasm and they'll die. Or I can just ignore them and... I feel like I need to pull this rope, but it feels like a pretty mean thing to do. Like, these guards that I'm fighting... Who are these guards? Are these legitimate guards that are, like, here lawfully and doing their job? Because I shouldn't be murdering those people if that's the case. Or are these bandit guards? Are these guys bad guys that have taken over the mines and, you know, they're you know, criminally here. And so, in that case, they kind of deserve what they get. I don't really know. That was never made clear to me. So just straight up murdering dudes, I'd like to think that the guys I beat in combat, I knocked them out or something. Nah, fuck it, I'm pulling the rope. They shouldn't have chased me. A smile flickers across your face as you give the rope a hefty tug. Confidently, you turn to watch your pursuers drop into the gaping mine shaft. Unfortunately, the only thing to drop is the heavy portcullis that has now sealed off the entrance to the tunnel. Your enemies cackle with glee and draw their weapons to strike. See, maybe they're evil, because they're cackling with glee. Who does that if you're just a normal guard? You cannot evade them and must fight them one at a time as they leap from the bridge. Alright, so this is a little bit more significant fight. I gotta fight 3 guys, one right after another. So let's fight the tunnel guard leader. He has 20 combat skill and 30 endurance. Alright, round 1. I lost none, he lost 18.
Round two. I lost none, he lost his remaining 12, so I made short work of him, didn't even get hurt. Goodbye, Tunnel Guard Leader. Tunnel Guard 1 has 18 combat skill and 26 endurance, he'll be a little bit easier. Round 1 against him. Screwed that up. Put in his numbers again. Round 1 against him. I lost 1, he lost 12. I lost none, he lost his remaining 14. So I killed him in 2 as well, but I took a tiny bit of damage. And finally, the third guy, who is the weakest of the lot. I'm not so worried about him. Round 1. I lost 2, he lost 10. Round 2. I lost 9, he lost his remaining 14. So, each of them took 2 rounds for me to kill, and total I lost, what, about 4 endurance total? So that was really pretty easy. That Summer Sword and now having a shield too gives me so much combat skill that, you know, I can just wreck. So, doing good. Killed all the guards. On the first body that you search, you find 8 gold crowns and enough food for 1 meal. You are about to search the others when you hear the sound of running footsteps approaching from the other side of the chamber. As you pull the rope once more and breathe a sigh of relief as the portcullis rises into the ceiling. Rolling under the widening gap, you jump to your feet and make a hasty escape along the tunnel. So, I'll heal myself. I'll take some more gold crowns. 8 more, I'm at 49, I'm almost maxed out. And I'm going to escape. Why do I even need to escape? I'll just stand here and kill all the guards. Like, if they're that easy to kill, bring on more of them. I'll chop them down one at a time as they cross the bridge. Alright, no, but let's turn to 348. Less than 50 yards along the tunnel wall, you notice a lever. Your Kai instincts make you naturally suspicious of this unusual feature, and you scour the floor looking for evidence of a trap. You find nothing, but a glance at the roof reveals the underside of a wide portcullis hidden between 2 beams. You pull the lever and the portcullis falls, sealing off the tunnel behind you. To make sure you will not be followed, you smash the lever with a wedge of stone before continuing along the tunnel. Alright, good. So now I shouldn't have to worry about being followed. Hold on. Yeah, okay. That healing discipline is so good. It's like the best one. It's seriously the best one. You are hungry and must now eat a meal or lose 3 more endurance. And no, I can't use hunting. Alright, well, I still don't have a meal, so lose another 3 endurance. Man, I've gotten hungry a lot in this book. Lone Wolf is a hungry motherfucker in the Chasm of Doom. He's hungry like the wolf. He's hungry like the lone wolf. You then continue along the tunnel, which runs for several miles before eventually arriving at a long, deserted gallery. I like art. It's probably not that kind of gallery. A line of empty ore wagons lie parked along a stretch of track that disappears into the west wall of this gallery. Above the arched tunnel, a flight of wooden stairs leads to a smaller passage lit by a sputtering torch. You stay hidden in the shadows, watching the gallery for half an hour before you are satisfied that it is safe to enter. I do have tracking, and I've reached the rank of aspirant or higher, yes. So I am prepared to do some awesome stuff here. Judging by the smoothness of the stone floor and the condition of the ore wagons, you deduce that this gallery must service a major section of the mines.
A fresh breeze can be felt blowing out of the west tunnel, and you sense that you must be near the surface. Ruinon lies due west, the same direction as the ore wagon tunnel. You take a deep breath and emerge from the shadows, cross the gallery, and quietly enter the archway beyond. Did I make it through the mines? Maybe not yet, but I'm on my way. As you make your way along the torchlit tunnel, you pass several ore wagons bearing the same design branded upon their wooden sides. A cross moline above the initials OV. You recognize the seal of Orin Vanilund, the Baron of Ruinon, and it confirms the fact that you are heading in the right direction. Suddenly, the sound of approaching footsteps begins to echo along the tunnel ahead. They become louder, accompanied now by shouting and the crack of a whip. And there's an illustration of what the cross moline looks like and the initials carved in. So I can dive into one of the empty ore wagons, or I can hide in the shadows of the rough tunnel wall. Well, I do have camouflage. I feel like hiding in the shadows of the rough tunnel wall sounds legit. Who knows what'll happen if I dive into an ore wagon? You wait with bated breath as a line of haggard men file past your barely concealed hiding place. An escort of bandit warriors urge them forward. Okay, so these guards are bandits. Good to know. Good to know. I don't feel so bad about murdering a bunch of them. An escort of bandit warriors urge them forward, beating any who falter or step out of the line. Then each man is forced to take hold of a wagon and push it back along the tunnel. Soon, they have all disappeared from view. See, I'm glad I didn't hide in a wagon. You wait, and when you are sure that the coast is clear, you step back into the tunnel and press on, taking care to keep well in the shadows. You finally reach a point where the tunnel emerges into daylight. To your left, a dense copse has been cut back from the entrance, and wagon tracks lead to a timber gantry above a mound of ore. The men and the guards who passed you are now at the gantry, but they fail to see you sprint from the entrance and dive into the trees. A brief pause for breath is all you allow yourself before setting off through the trees towards Ruinon. So now I made it through the mines. 27. I'm almost fully healed up. The trees are alive with bandit patrols, but your quick wits and Kai skills prevent you from being seen by them. Eventually, you reach the edge of the copse. You find yourself staring out across an expanse of open plain towards Ruinon. The sight that lies before you is very disquieting. Much of the mining town has been burnt to the ground. The blackened ruins of what were once shops, cottages, and taverns are now little more than smoldering mounds of charcoal. You are beginning to fear the worst, that Ruinon has been totally destroyed, when a gentle breeze clears the haze of wood smoke hanging like a gray curtain over the ruins. Inside the perimeter of ruined buildings, a barricade has been thrown up around a tower of stone. Above the tower, a tattered flag still flies, bringing renewed hope. It is the sun flag of Summerland, edged with a band of white braid, the cavalry standard of the Kingsguard Regiment. And there's an image of what the standard looks like. Pretty cool. The sudden crack of a twig makes you freeze. You glance behind you to see three bandits creeping through the trees towards you. The wide steel tips of their spears glint. They seem to be coated with a clear, sticky fluid. Ah, I recognize this. I have visited Gorn Cove, and in fact somebody tried to poison me with this exact stuff, I think, in Gorn Cove.
So yes, I have hunting as well, and I've visited Gorn Cove. You recognize Gnadern sap dripping from their spears. It is a deadly poison. You dare not risk engaging in combat with these bandits, for the merest graze from one of their tainted weapons could be fatal. Leaping to your feet, you race away from the trees and run towards Ruinon. Good to know. Gnadern sap. It's bad stuff. Gnadern sap's a hell of a drug. From all along the forest edge, groups of bandits emerge from the trees, whipped and scolded by their bullying sergeants for allowing you to escape. This spurs you to quicken your pace, and you cover the first 100 yards with ease. Then arrows begin to fall around you. You duck and weave, making yourself a difficult target for the archers, and gradually the falling shafts dwindle in number. You smile at their futile attempts to stop you, but your confidence is soon shaken by a pack of snarling warhounds breaking out of the woods to your right. They are off the leash and hungry for blood. You are less than 500 yards from Ruinon, but the warhounds are closing in. Well, there's no way I'm going to outrun warhounds over a 500-yard run. That's just not going to happen. They're going to run me down, so I need to stop and fight them. The warhounds lope towards you at an unnerving speed. You can see their great red-lipped jaws clearly and hear the clacking of their fangs. You fight to control your breathing, to concentrate all your warrior skills, for you must dispatch the warhounds quickly and with precision if you are to avoid being torn to pieces. Two dogs, faster than their brothers, break free of the pack and close upon you. They leap simultaneously, their slavering jaws spread wide for attack. You dive forward and roll, striking at their bellies from beneath as they pass above. Both howl with rage and pain and tumble lifeless to the ground. You are back on your feet as the next warhound attacks. So I need to win this combat in 3 rounds or less, versus the Vasagonian warhound. Not so worried about it. Combat skill is much inferior to mine. Round one. I lost 2. It lost 9. Round two. I lost 0. It lost the entire 16 that it had left. So I killed it in 2 rounds. No problemo. Beyond the approaching warhound pack, you can see that a dozen bandit archers are closing in. If you were to survive the rending jaws of the warhounds, the archers would be sure to pick you off with ease. Without wasting a second, you turn towards Ruinon and run as fast as your legs will carry you. While healing. While still healing. I could get a drink of water here. You try to ignore your aching legs and the fear that knots your stomach by forcing your concentration on the sun flag, a fluttering symbol of hope in the distance. Your face is streaked with sweat, and your lungs feel as though they will burst, but you dare not slacken your pace. The thought of warhound fangs closing and tugging on your skin is all you need to drive you forward. At 400 yards, you can see that the barricade and watchtower are inhabited, but at this distance, the faces you can see are only a line of small pink dots on the walls. At 300 yards, you run into some gruesome remains, where the corpses of bandits lie twisted on the ground, most killed by arrows. Many have lain in the open for weeks. A flock of startled carrion crows rise shrieking from their feast as you race through the bodies. You turn away in disgust. Suddenly, a new sound drifts across the plain, the sound of cheering. The beleaguered defenders have spotted you and recognized your green Kai cloak. 200 yards to go. You have just passed the ruins of a burnt-out cottage when you feel an agonizing pain tear through your left thigh. An arrow has pierced your leg, and you pitch forward into the mud and ash. Crouched in the ruined cottage, a bandit sniper raises his bow and takes careful aim at your head.
Pick a random number to see whether or not you die. If you get a zero, that's instant death. These other ones, I don't know which is good and which is bad. Let's see what I got. A four. All right, well, numbers 1 through 5. Let's see what happens. Well, I'm still alive. Surprised it didn't make me lose any endurance from that arrow hitting me. An arrow hisses overhead. A scream of agony fills the air. The bow slips from the archer's fingers as he sinks to his knees, the arrow lodged deep between his startled eyes. The clack of fangs and the soft, swift pad of stealthy feet tell you that the warhounds are closing in. You look up to see a man running towards you from the barricade. He has a shield in one hand and a longbow in the other. He's using a bow with a shield? How does that work, buddy? It is Guard Captain Duval. I've got your sword. He reaches you, breathless from his run, and draws an arrow from his quiver. Duval aims and fires, drawing another arrow from his quiver as soon as the first is loosed. The warhounds tumble and crash to the ground around you, felled by Duval's deadly shafts. 8 lie dead before his quiver is empty. I'm going to assume it's just a buckler. He's got a buckler on his arm. Because otherwise, the thought of him drawing all these arrows and rapid firing with a bow with a big old normal shield, just, it's not working for me in my mind. We're going to call it a buckler. So there's an image of Captain Duval shooting dogs. Dog Slayer. The captain grabs you by the arm and, swinging you over his shoulder in one swift motion, carries you back toward the barricade. Others run forward to help you, but the bandit archers are now in range and your men are forced back by a hail of arrows. The red shafts of the enemy whistle past on all sides. You reach the barricade, a wagon is pulled aside, and you are carried in through the gap. Captain Duval is close to exhaustion. He staggers, and his men rush to catch him before he drops to the ground. A circle of unshaven faces are staring down at you. A soldier cradles your leg as another snaps the shaft buried deeply in your thigh. But before you can even cry out in pain, he has drawn the arrow from your leg with one swift tug. "You're very lucky, Kai Lord," he says as he bandages a handful of Lamspur to your aching limb. "The wound is clean and the bleeding is but slight." You lose 4 endurance points, but the soldier's quick thinking and skill has saved your leg from infection. With great care, the soldiers carry both you and Captain Duval into the stone watchtower. Ow. Then I do some healing of my own.
"I was hoping the king would send a large search party," says Captain Duval wryly, now having fully recovered from his exhaustion. "I was beginning to tire of this town."
You rise from your straw bed and offer your thanks to the captain. His brave and timely action saved you from certain death.
"'Tis nothing to compare with you, Lone Wolf. Your bravery is legend. Your presence here is worth 100 men."
He asks you about your mission, and you recount the events that have led you to this meeting. The ride south, the loss of your company, your passage through the Machin mines and the bandits.
"Yes, the bandits. Baraka's men," retorts Duval, his gruff voice conveying his contempt for them and their leader. "It seems we have both suffered at his hand. A month ago, he and his Vasagonian renegades ambushed my troop on the Ruinon Pike. We were sorely outnumbered and the fight was indeed bitter, but we broke free from them and escaped here to Ruinon. We have been beleaguered ever since and praying for help to arrive. We have enough weapons to resist them, but we have barely enough food and water to survive."
You ask what has become of the people of Ruinon.
"Most are now slaves. Baraka has taken the mines and he uses the Ruinese as forced labor. Other than yourself, only one man has escaped from the mines and survived the warhounds and the bandit snipers. That man is Baron Oren Vanilund. Come, I shall take you to him.
Duval leads you to the topmost chamber of the watchtower and pushes open an iron-shod door. The sight that greets you fills your heart with sorrow and pity. Well, that sounds ominous. 26 piece. Oren Vanilund is the 15th Baron of Ruinon, a noble warrior of royal lineage and fifth in succession to the throne of Somerland. This once proud and chivalrous warlord now lies upon the cold stone floor of the chamber, red-eyed and whimpering like a frightened dog.
He has lost everything, says Duval quietly. Baraka has destroyed his castle, his land, his town, and his family. His sons are dead, and his only daughter has been taken captive by Baraka himself. I fear the ordeal has turned his mind.
And here we have an image of a ruined castle in the background and somebody tied up to a post with an arrows in them and a crow. This doesn't seem like it has a whole lot to do with the Baron, other than just showing how screwed everything is in his lands, I guess.
The pathetic man raises his tear-stained face and with feeble voice mutters a curious rhyme over and over again. I remember this rhyme. This is from the scroll that we saw earlier. This is the prophecy. And I thought of this as soon as they said his daughter had been taken captive. I was like, oh, there, she's going to get sacrificed. When a fair royal maid on the altar dies, the dead of Mockingorge shall rise. Yeah, I do possess a scroll. As you unfurl the scroll and begin to read its ominous contents, the Baron struggles to his feet. Word for word, he echoes the prophetic verse.
When the full moon shines o'er the temple deep, a sacrifice will stir from sleep the legions of a long-forgotten lord. When a fair royal maid on the altar dies, the dead of Mockingorge shall rise to claim their long-awaited reward. You must save her, Lone Wolf.
Who? Lone Wolf is his name, right?
You must save her, Lone Wolf. You must prevent the sacrifice.
The Baron's voice is choked with emotion.
Save who? Who must he save?
Questions Captain Duval as he tries to calm the distressed Baron.
My daughter, Madeline! Baraka has found the dagger of Vashna. He plans to sacrifice my daughter upon the altar of Makan to release the undead of Mockingorge.
That sounds bad. The Baron explains that during the Age of the Black Moon, King Ulnar of Somerland killed the mightiest of all the Dark Nords, Vashna, with the Sommersword, the Sword of the Sun. I have that. His body and the bodies of all his soldiers were hurled into the bottomless abyss of Mockingorge.
He plans to lead the dead to victory first, to conquer Somerland and then all of the last lands,
he says in despair. You stare at the Baron in stunned silence. If Baraka completes the sacrifice, all is lost. What mortal army can stand against the Legion of the Dead? Well, I got the Sommersword. I can pretty much take him out. Captain Duval ushers you from the chamber and closes the door.
I feared he was insane, but your scroll confirms my worst nightmare. He speaks the truth.
As the dreadful significance of the verse begins to sink in, your thoughts are broken by the shrill blast of a war horn. Captain Duval strides over to an arrow slit and peers out across the plain. As he turns to speak, you notice that his face is ashen gray.
The bandits! They're launching an attack!
I do possess Captain Duval's sword, as it turns out. I got it so I could give it to him specifically for this reason. And also heal myself up.
You draw the sword and offer it to the captain. A look of surprise and delight crosses his face as he examines the blade.
I never expected to see my trusty steel again. It is a good omen for the battle ahead.
Thanking you, the captain sheathes his sword in its scabbard that, until now, has hung empty from its belt.
Feels good to give a guy his sword back. Alright, I don't need to heal anymore. I'm fully healed, I guess.
You follow Captain Duval as he hurries down the broad watchtower steps and out to the barricade. A rolling sound like distant thunder fills the air. Cavalry are pouring onto the plain from all sides, grouping up into battalions in preparation for the advance. Columns of foot soldiers in bright scarlet armor march through their ranks, herding a frightened wall of people before them.
They're Rouennese! Cries Duval, his hand shielding the light from his eyes. That Colonel Baraka is using them as a shield!
All around you, the captain's men have drawn their bowstrings, awaiting his signal to fire. But it is an order he dare not give. Suddenly, a hidden catapult hurls a massive black rock through the air, straight towards the barricade. You stare in horror as it bursts into flame and disintegrates, showering a rain of blazing oil on everyone beneath. The soldiers cannot evade the deluge, and many are badly burnt before the flames are smothered. A battle cry resounds from the enemy ranks, the signal to attack. The Rouennese are pushed aside and trampled by the onrush of scarlet warriors who now race towards the barricade.
There's the image of soldiers having a bad day, exploding fire rocks in the air, people burning. That guy's just, he's not happy.
The blazing oil has scattered Duval's men, and the barricade is poorly defended. You hear Duval shout your name, his cloak and tunic are ablaze, and he is screaming for your help.
I have reached the Kai rank of Warmarn, as it turns out. Yes, I have. That's the same as Journeyman.
You must rally the defenders or all is lost. You order two soldiers to help the captain, and then leap onto an overturned wagon in order to see clearly the enemy advance. They have already reached the ruined perimeter of Rouennon, and are now creeping forward under cover of the broken cottage walls. You shout orders to Duval's men to defend the barricade, but the enemy are less than 100 yards from the wall. You are afraid it might be too late to repel their attack. The Vasagonian bandits break cover and charge, and you give the order to fire. A cloud of arrows sweeps down upon the armor-clad men, the hardened tips penetrating their scarlet plate. The first wave of assailants tumbles and falls. The second wave falters. Another volley forces them back, and they retreat to the ruins to reorganize themselves. Here and there, groups of bandit warriors have survived the hail of death and reached the barricade. Most are slain as they try to enter, but a small and determined section of their boldest fighters have broken through close to where you stand. Suddenly, a thick-bodied warrior with oily black hair tied in a knot at the back of his scarred head leaps onto the wagon and attacks you. I must now face the Vasagonian warrior,
who doesn't look that tough to me. Alright, let's do this. Round one. I lost none. He lost 18. Round two. I lost three. He died. Vasagonian warrior, if that's the best you can do, I'll fight many more of you. I won, and I start healing myself.
Duval runs past the wagon, leading a dozen of his best swordsmen in a countercharge, and driving the enemy all the way back to the barricade. None escape alive. Those who survive Duval's swordsmen are cut down on the plain by his archers as they run towards the ruins. The shout of victory has barely died away before you are faced by a new threat.
So we just got attacked by a whole army and I only had to kill one guy? Alright. Things are getting serious now. Healing.
A mantlet, a large shield on wheels, is being pushed slowly across the body-strewn battleground towards the barricade. Arrow shafts soon bristle from its thick wooden planks as Duval's men fire their bows time and time again in an attempt to hit the shielded foe.
Here's a nice illustration of the mantlet being pushed forward, little slot to look through, arrows sticking into it, bodies.
Suddenly, a robed figure darts from behind the mantlet and levels a black staff at the barricade. He is cut down by an arrow, but not before he has let loose from his staff a guttering ball of flame. It cartwheels across the plain and explodes with a tremendous roar, hurling the bodies of defenders and shattered barricade high into the air. Through the cloud of dust and debris, you can see a line of enemy cavalry charging across the plain. They wear tall, plumed helmets of polished steel and breastplates of deepest crimson. In the wake of the fireball, they pour through the remains of the barricade and attack. They give no quarter. A horseman spurs his horse towards you, his lance leveled at your chest. Wait a minute, have we reached the cover art? We've reached the cover art! There's the mantlet, you can see the corner of the mantlet right there. And we're at the barricade, and he's leaping over and he's leveling his lance at my chest. We've reached the cover art, folks. Alright. I'm gonna stand and fight the horseman, because that's what I do. The horseman is charging at you very quickly. You will only be able to fight for one round of combat before the momentum of his attack carries him past you. Alright, let's see what happens in this one round. He has 20 combat skill, which is pretty impressive, but it's not as good as mine. I have 27, he has 28. I have 24, he has 20. He lost 8, I lost 3. That's what I'm talking about. If you lose more endurance, if he loses more endurance... No, he lost more endurance than me. So 24... And then I heal up in this next section, so I'm back up to 25. Your blow has unhorsed the bandit. He falls to the ground heavily, shattering his lance beneath him. He staggers to his feet, and, raising the hinged eye shield of his helm, he stares at you and smiles wickedly, exposing a jagged line of blackened teeth. He spits his battle cry and runs towards you, unsheathing a broadsword as he closes in. The only thing I'm really scared about this guy is his breath. Apparently he has some very poor oral hygiene. I'll fight him. I'll kill this fucker. Bandit horseman. You are in combat with a Vasagonian horseman who is now on foot. You cannot evade him and must fight him to the death. Yeah, I'm not worried.
Now his combat skill is only 17. Got the games. Alright, I have 25, he has 24. Round 1. He loses 18. I lose 0. Round 2. I lost 3. He got me with a last little jab. But then he dies. Of course I won. Heal up.
You run half-crouched to the barricade and prize a bow from the hand of a dead soldier. You have spotted the leader of the bandit cavalry, a tall, dark-skinned warrior with a thin, chiseled nose, rallying his horsemen at the foot of the stone watchtower. You know you must kill him before he can regroup his troops, or Duval and his hard-pressed men will be ridden down and mercilessly slaughtered. Here's the leader of the cavalry. He has a pretty cool-looking breastplate there. Interesting, exotic-looking helmet as well. You notch an arrow and draw back the bowstring. The straining cord bites into your fingers as you take aim. Pick a random number. I do not have the Kai discipline of weapon skill, so I don't get to add 2. So I really want to roll high. If I roll 8 or 9, that would be best. I rolled an 8! Yes! Yeah! Even without weapon skill, I got the best result. That's awesome. The arrow arcs through the smoke-blackened sky and pierces the officer's shining breastplate. You hear his scream of pain ring out above the din of battle and watch as his cruel eyes flicker and close. He swoons and slips from his saddle, your arrow lodged deep in his heart. Feels good. Feels really good. I'm like, I don't even use a bow. I just picked one up and killed you with it.
To me! To me!
Captain Duval's voice booms out above the battle noise.
Rally to me, Somlending!
The brave captain draws about him a shielded wedge of soldiers and charges into the flank of the horsemen. They reel and buckle as the shield wedge hews its way through their company. A Vasagonian herald, his crimson armor torn and his face smeared with blood, breaks free from the battle and sounds the retreat. You watch as the surviving bandits spur their mounts to the gallop, desperate to escape through the ragged hole in the barricade. Gripped by panic and fatigue, they ride through their own foot soldiers who are advancing to support them. The infantry falter and collapse as the cavalry ride them down. They got a pretty cool banner with a scorpion on it there. That must be with the herald blowing the retreat horn. Arrows piercing through dudes' necks and stuff. That guy looks pretty scared. Captain Duval leads his men to the barricade and directs a lethal volley of arrows into the shattered infantry. It is the last straw. They throw down their weapons and flee from the clouds of arrows raining down on them from out of the smoke-filled sky. A battle cry, proud and strident, pursues them across the plain.
For Summerland! For Summerland!
That's right. For Summerland, son. Fully healed. All around the barricade, the enemy are retreating in disorder. Bandit war horns announce the withdrawal, exhorting their defeated warriors to flee the battlefield. A jubilant Captain Duval emerges from the war smoke, his eyes shining like jewels beneath the rim of his battered helmet.
We have triumphed, Lone Wolf! We have vanquished the foe!
All around you, the captain's men are rebuilding the barricade and tending to their wounded comrades. It sorrows you to see Somlending dead, but you take heart at how few they are beside the enemy's losses. The captain ushers you to the watchtower where your wounds are cleaned and dressed with Lamspur. The herbs restore 6 endurance points. Fully healed.
We have beaten this foe, but I fear that it is but a temporary reprieve, says the captain, his face now composed and somber. The sacrifice of Baron Vanelin's daughter must be stopped if we are to avoid catastrophe, for our strength will not avail us against a foe freshly risen from the grave.
The words of the verse flood into your mind, and a chill runs down your spine as you realize what may lie ahead. In 3 days' time, when the moon is full, Baraka will sacrifice the Baron's daughter at the buried temple of Machen, a sacrifice that will unleash the dead of Machen Gorge, the Chasm of Doom. Dun-dun-dun, it's the name of the book. You know you must prevent the sacrifice. Chasm of Doom, the Chasm of Doom. I mean, we've already passed the cover art, though, so at this point, everything's anticlimactic. Not really. Hold on, water.
My throat loves me reading these books. So much reading out loud all at once. It's a big fan.
50 miles south of Ruinon, the ruined city of Machen teeters on the brink of Machen Gorge. A cold sweat breaks out upon your brow as you contemplate the difficulty of your mission, for you are separated from your goal by 50 miles of enemy-held territory. But there is still a flicker of hope. With the enemy in confusion and retreat, your chances of success will be far higher now than before battle. Before you set off on your perilous mission, Captain Duval offers you the choice of the following equipment and provisions. Enough food for 3 meals. Don't need it. Don't have room for it. A rope, got one. Potion of Lamspur. Sword, a spear. I'll take a spear. Rest of that stuff though, I'm good. It also says if you don't have a backpack, you can choose to assume here that you're outfitted with one by Captain Duval, but I do. I have lost my backpack in the past, but not today. Alright, let's keep going. Dusk soon enshrouds the beleaguered outpost of Ruinon, and you use the cover of darkness to cross the body-strewn plain towards the south. An old highway trails off to Machen, but it is choked with Vasagonian warriors. They stand about in sullen groups, tending their wounded and brooding on their defeat. However, even demoralized and dejected, they are still a deadly foe. It will be too dangerous to risk passing through their ranks, so you must use the forest to conceal your passage. I can venture through the trees to the right of the highway, or I can venture through the trees to the left.
Well, one choice seems as good as another to me at this point, so I'll just arbitrarily say the left.
The forest is patrolled by bandits, but they take little interest in their guard duties, and you find it easy to avoid them in the dark. Then, by chance, you come across a small log cabin hidden deep in the woods. A candle flickers at the window, and the door is ajar. I will enter the hut. There's a candle. The door slams shut, and you spin round to see a bandit leaping at you from the shadows. His head is a mass of bloodied bandages, but he is armed and determined to fight.
He is really weak, though. Wounded bandit. He fights you with his back to the door, and you cannot evade him. Yeah, I'm unconcerned. This is my unconcerned face. You can't see it, but it's on my face right now. Round one!
I lose no endurance. He dies. I just outright killed him.
That's hilarious. Well, he's not wounded anymore. Now he's dead.
You roll the dead bandit over with the toe of your boot and make a quick search of his body. You discover the following items: 3 gold crowns, a dagger, and a sword.
I'll take a crown. I maxed out. 50 is as much as I can carry. I'll take the other 2 gold crowns and place them over his eyes.
You may take any of the above items. As you are leaving, you notice a trap door in the floor. Opening it, you see that it leads down into the cellar of the building.
I'll search the cellar. Why not?
Oh! Instant death! Instant death! I managed to die in this book. Okay. Sometimes you make a bad choice and this happens.
You are at the bottom of the cellar ladder when the trapdoor slams shut and you hear a bolt slide across and lock. You hammer on the trapdoor, desperately trying to escape, but your captors cover the trapdoor with a heavy oak cask and keep guard in the room above. 4 days pass before the lock slides back, but the hands that open the trapdoor are bony and fleshless. Your life and your mission end here.
Trapped in a cellar. Rough way to go. Okay, well, that's one death for this book.
I guess I'll leave the hut then. How does that sound?
You quickly leave the hut far behind and press on through the trees. By morning, you have reached the edge of the forest. Staring out across the fields of tall crops, you see a small village lying at the base of a shallow valley. The fields are only separated by narrow tracks, which are alive with flying insects hovering in swarms. You are walking along the track when you suddenly spot bandits ahead. They are wandering idly up the track towards you, their spears slung over their shoulders. There's a picture of bandits with spears slung over their shoulders. You guys got a respectable porn stash coming in back there. You possess an onyx medallion. I don't have one of those, unfortunately. I wish I did. It sounds cool. I've got a blue stone triangle. How does that sound? No? Okay. If I have camouflage and I'm guardian or higher, which I am, so let's do that. Lifting your feet high, you step into the tall crops, taking care to part them first with your hands. You allow the stalks to close again behind your back before you crouch down and hold your breath. You have completely vanished from sight. It is as if the stalks have never been disturbed. I'm a pro at this. The bandits amble past, barely inches from where you hide, oblivious to your presence. When you are sure they have gone, you emerge from the crops and hurry away. You bypass a village with orange wood cabins and stone walls and climb through the tall fields towards a wooded ridge. Beyond the ridge, you enter thick forest and discover a bubbling freshwater stream. You drink deeply and realize how hungry you are. You must eat a meal here or lose 3 endurance points. But here I can use hunting, so I just use hunting and I don't have to have a meal. As night falls, you reach the city of Machen. The gaunt, weed-infested ruins of this shattered city are spread like a vast graveyard and bathed in the eerie light of a near full moon. A sound fills the air like the wailing of lost souls. It is the cry of Machen Gorge. It has been nearly 2 days since you last slept, and fatigue begins to overwhelm you. Drawing your Kai cloak about your shoulders, you settle down to sleep. You will need all your strength for the daunting task that lies ahead. Nap time. Dawn arrives, rain-swept and gloom-laden. A pall of drizzle hangs over the ghost city, and the gruesome discord of the wailing winds of Machen Gorge makes you feel uneasy. You watch and wait, your Kai cloak drawn close about your shoulders to keep out the chill, damp air. It was here, during the Age of the Black Moon, that King Ulnar of Summerland killed the mightiest of the Dark Lords, Lord Vashna. In mortal combat, upon the very brink of the abyss, the Dark Lord was slain by the Sommersword. It is said that his death cry when he fell will echo through the gorge until the day he rises to wreak his vengeance on Summerland and the House of Ulnar. Your stomach contracts at the thought that this could be that very day. For 5 hours, you observe and take in every detail of the ruined city. The first line of the strange verse keeps repeating itself in your mind. When the full moon shines o'er the temple deep. The temple must be underground, and there must be an entrance to it. But where? You study every crack in the broken ground and eliminate all but 2 possibilities. A crypt door guarded by 2 Vasigonian warriors, and a flight of marble steps descending into the earth between 2 columns of fractured pillars. Here's a picture of the 2 warriors guarding the crypt. Nice shield, that's pretty cool. Got the curved dagger going on. These guys ain't playing. They're fully outfitted. Alright, go through the guarded crypt door or enter the temple via the unguarded stairs. Here's the thing. I would normally think these stairs seem like the way forward, because they seem more like going into a temple, right? Marble steps, ascending in between pillars. But the stairs aren't guarded, and the crypt door is guarded. So the fact that it's guarded implies that maybe that's the way, because that's what they want to keep people out of. So I'm going to try to go through the guarded door, even though that means they're probably going to have to chop these guys up. You manage to reach a tangle of briars growing near the crypt door, and from here you can observe the Vasigonian guards undetected. More soldiers appear on horseback, riding into Machen from the north. They dismount and approach the door.
Password!
Shout the crypt guards.
Lawn!
Reply the soldiers. The door opens and they are allowed to enter. Armed with the password, you decide to try to enter in the same way. Keeping the hood of your cloak raised and your somlending features in shadow, you walk boldly towards the guards. The guards are not going to be like, hey, aren't our uniforms red? Why is this dude with a green cloak rolling up? But let's not break it down too much. I pick a random number, and because I have camouflage, I get to add 4 to the number. So I need a 7, it looks like. I'm going to need to roll a 3 or higher. Let's do this. I got a 5. I made it. Don't have to kill these guys. Your bravado has paid off. The guards accept the password and allow you to enter the crypt. As the stone door is drawn shut, you find yourself in a wide, torch-lit corridor heading towards the east. The corridor ends at a flight of steps that descends 100 feet into the earth. At the bottom, a short passage leads to a junction where a tunnel runs from north to south. To the north, you can see a torchlit cavern with what appear to be observation slits carved into the wall. To the south, the passage leads towards a low balcony. I kind of want to see what's over the balcony. Can't resist a good balcony. So I do wish to take a look over the low balcony. An empty feeling grips your stomach as you stare upon the altar and inner sanctum of the subterranean temple. Your Kai senses burn as if every nerve in your body is screaming a warning to flee from this evil chamber. Huge braziers of molten metal encircle a black altar upon which lies Fair Madeline, the daughter of Baron Vanilland. She seems to be entranced. Her breathing is slow and shallow. Beyond the altar lie 2 massive doors, a gigantic skull engraved upon their black stone surface. Out of your view, another door opens and a procession of red-cloaked priests enters the temple. Their heads are covered, and they each carry strange amulets of black stone. They file past the altar, depositing the amulets. In a circle around the young girl's body, and then file out again in total silence. Then you hear the sound of a distant drumbeat. It grows louder and nearer. The measured steps of steel-shod boots resound in its wake. Baraka is approaching. There's like the creepy-looking priests. Got the skull and curved dagger and magic business on the banner here. Guy's got some skulls right there on his collar. Quite a hat there, too. What's up, Conehead?
Baraka carries the stench of death and decay about him. He strides into the temple, his boots of gorgaz hide covering both legs and feet, and slams shut the huge stone door with frightening ease.
He stands in silence before pushing open the huge black doors engraved with the menacing skulls. Suddenly, a gale force wind sweeps through the temple, and your ears are filled by a terrible scream. Beyond the open doors, a pier of stone juts into the abyss of Machin Gorge. You are staring into the Chasm of Doom. The Chasm of Doom, it's the name of the book. The Chasm of Doom, here it is.
Baraka turns away from the windswept pier and walks slowly towards the altar. From a hidden scabbard, he removes a twisted black dagger and holds its stiletto blade to the light. An evil blue flame runs up and down the black steel spike, flickering in the ice-cold winds of Machin Gorge. The sacrifice is about to begin.
There's the evil dagger of Vashna. Although, in fairness, that looks like a Chris blade. So it's a wavy blade, it's a Chris knife, not a stiletto, which is a straight. But let's not quibble over details here. Maybe Joe Deaver isn't, you know, a knife expert. That's fine. I'm not gonna judge.
draw my weapon and attack him, or distract his attention without attacking him? I'm kind of feeling the attack him option, really. Like, why be subtle at this point? Here we are, it's time to do it. Right? Yeah. This is where it's like, if you don't possess a Sommer Sword, you just lose and die. If you do, you can actually fight for real. If you possess a Sommer Sword, yes I do. As you raise your golden sword, the howling wind seems to rise in pitch and intensity. It claws at your mind, filling your head with terrible images of death and horror. Baraka sees you falter and strikes a cruel blow that opens a wound in your cheek. You lose one endurance point. But the sudden pain reawakens you to the presence of your enemy, and the combat begins. So he's pretty fairly matched with me. Same combat skill, slightly more endurance. You are being attacked by a very powerful mind blast. Unless you possess the Kai discipline of mind shield, as it happens I do, I just got it this book, thank you. Your combat skill is reduced by 4 for the duration of this combat. However, Baraka himself is a warrior who possesses formidable strength of will. He is immune to mind blast. That's fine, let's do this. Finally can fight somebody a little more on my level. I think you just outright lose if you don't have the Sommer Sword and you try to fight him. I'm not sure though. If you win, turn to 350. 350 is the always the you win section. So let's do the battle. 27-29, round 1. He lost 6, I lost 3. Round 2. Ooh, round 2 didn't go well for him at all. He lost 11, I lost none. Round 3. I lost none, he lost 10. Oh, you're getting smoked, Baraka. You're getting punked, sir. Let's finish him off. Last round. He hurt me a little bit, but I killed him. I killed him hard. Killed him strong. It took 4 rounds, though. But I thought I was going to lose more endurance in that. I really did. It would have hurt, though, if I didn't have Mind Shield, because having my combat skill 4 lower than his would have changed those rolls quite a bit. It would have hurt. But fortunately, I did have Mind Shield. Turn to 350. This is the end of the book. We win. As Baraka dies, the wind suddenly rises in pitch and intensity, filling the temple with a mournful cry of despair. You feel the chill, malevolent spirit of Dark Lord Vashna engulfing you in an icy embrace, but you sense that he is powerless to harm you. The sacrifice has been foiled. He is doomed to lament for a victory that might have been. Lying on the Black Temple floor is the dagger of Vashna. As you pick it up and tuck it into your belt, mark this on your action chart as a special item, the evil blue flame flickers and dies. As long as you possess this evil blade, Dark Lord Vashna and his legion of dead warriors will remain imprisoned in the Chasm of Doom. Alright, I'll take care of your dagger of Vashna. You free fair Madeline from the altar and carry her through the corridors of the temple that lead up to the surface. As you emerge into the moonlit ruins, an astounding sight greets your eyes. Baraka's warriors are running from the ghost city in all directions, closely pursued by an army of cavalrymen. The light of the full moon and the guttering torches that these horsemen carry illuminates the sun crest that bedecks their tunics. Word must have reached Homeguard, for they are the Somlending army led by King Olnar himself. Your countrymen praise your courage and daring, their strident cheers drowning the cry of Machangorge. For once again, you have proved yourself a true hero of Somerland. As you deliver Madeline into the waiting arms of her father, his overwhelming joy fills you with a sense of great achievement. You are indeed worthy of the title Kai Lord. You have succeeded in your perilous quest, but the epic saga of Lone Wolf, Last of the Kai Lords, is far from complete.
a new and deadly challenge awaits you in Book 5 of the Lone Wolf series, entitled Shadow on the Sand. That's the one where you go to Vasagonia. That one's pretty cool. So, we have an image of the Vasagonian bandits running in terror. There's the big full moon with the cavalrymen with the big banner of Somerland silhouetted there. That's a pretty cool picture. And we won. We did it. It's over. Yay. That is the end of Book 4 of the Lone Wolf series, The Chasm of Doom. We did it. I did die once, though. I died once, legitimately. So, Books 1, 2, and 4, all of them, I died once. Book 3, I managed to get through without dying, somehow. Usually I make one dumb choice per book, at least, you know, that gets me killed. But, pretty much handled business there. Good times. So that's gonna do it for this episode. Next time, we will go forth. We'll do Book 5, Shadow on the Sand. But that's gonna do it for this one. Thank you for watching. This has been Josiah Plays Lone Wolf, Book 4, The Chasm of Doom.